As I saw these suffering children, mostly accompanied by their mothers, with pain and misery in their eyes, I was told how proud I should be that the ward was partly funded by the British. At the end of the visit, the governor took me up onto the ancient walls of the city for a final view of the devastation and served from an ornate pot the best cup of coffee I have ever tasted. Before the war, coffee was one of Yemen's leading exports. As we left for the long journey back to Sana'a, my interpreter asked if I remembered the woman who the night before had shown me the shrapnel fragments. I said I did indeed. Well, he said, I did not accurately translate what she said. What she had actually said was, "These are your gifts and tomorrow we will get you." I told him it was just as well he hadn't told me, as the city tour would have had to be cancelled. Too many people could have been put in harm's way. Once back in Sana'a, I went to meet the Houthi foreign minister, Hisham Sharaf Abdullah, with whom I got on well. He was American-educated, smart, cynical and persuasive. We went together to see Salah Ali al-Samad, the Houthi leader, who told me that in spite of Britain's appalling conduct, he wanted the UK and the Russians to mediate with the Saudis. He said that as a token of goodwill, he would agree to withdraw all Houthi assets 20 kilometres from the Saudi border and cease sporadic missile attacks on Saudi territory. In return, he expected an end to indiscriminate Saudi bombing. The night before, a bus with schoolchildren had been hit while returning to Sana'a, killing 28, their bodies laid out at the side of the road, together with their satchels and school smocks. Apparently the target had been a petrol station. I promised to brief the Foreign Office and thanked him for letting me come. He was generous about my visit and gave me a magnificent Houthi knife, which the UN managed to get back to the UK. From our conversation, it was clear that he was a dove when it came to the peace talks,